We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
And it's time now on 4 to relive the decade of the 60s and the American race for the stars.
For centuries, we have reached for it with our hands stretched into the sky, ever-changing, mysterious, and full of shining wonder. Through the ages, it has been a celestial inspiration for explorers and poets.
Decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
Only in our lifetime have men touched its silver surface.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
This is the story of those first steps, the reasons we took them, and what paths still await us in the universe beyond. It is a story of triumph and tragedy. It is the story of spaceflight. Cape Kennedy, Launch Complex 34, January 27th, 1967. On this Friday morning, NASA begins the final launch rehearsal for its new Apollo spacecraft. The Saturn 1B rocket contains no fuel, and the test is not considered dangerous. It is a test that will end in tragedy for America's space program and its first three Apollo astronauts, Virgil Gus Grissom, Edward White, and Roger Chaffee. For nearly a year, the crew had closely watched the development of the Apollo command module. Its complexity far outrivals previous Mercury and Gemini spacecraft, and so do its problems. Wally Schirra, backup commander to the first Apollo mission.
We were looking at this Block 1 spacecraft and feeling nervous about it, to a point where I said, I don't want to fly a Block 1. Let's cancel the second Block 1 spacecraft. I can remember very vividly the night before the guys were killed in that spacecraft, saying to Gus, if you have one glitch, get out of there. I didn't like it.
In the early afternoon, the Apollo crew enters the cabin. Grissom reports a strange odor. The test is delayed until nearly sunset. At the blockhouse console, Deke Slayton.
The problem we had here was that we pressure checked the vehicle on the pad with pure oxygen, which is a simple thing to do. And 15 pounds pressure of oxygen is a very dangerous thing. And from some cause, as far as I know, yet unknown, we ended up with a spark in there about the same time frame that we had this thing pumped up for a pressure check. It had been done many times before. But now when you have an ignition source and that amount of oxygen, you've essentially got a bomb.
Okay, we're ready to pick up, Chuck. About all we can do is give it a try.
You copy?
No, I didn't read you, Chuck, at all. You want to try the phone?
How about the flight? How are you going to get the moon? We can't fly between three buildings.
Jesus Christ.
Are you guys back together up there at the command module? And then how are we going to get the moon? We can't fly between two buildings.
At 6:31, a cry is heard over the radio circuit. There is a fire in here. In a matter of seconds, it is over. The three astronauts are dead, lost not in space, but on the ground.
Well, I was going to be the flight director for the first Apollo flight. And I was on the console at the time it happened. And it was a terrible experience. But you can't, in our business, in our business, remember, was the flight test business, we didn't kill a lot of people, but it was not unusual for people to die in the conduct of getting the job done. I don't want to sound callous about it, because I was not callous at the time. I don't know how I survived it, because all three of those men were very close friends of mine. But nevertheless, we were knowledgeable that someday it might happen, and someday it's going to happen again, and you can't just give up and have nothing but despair. You've got to do enough introspection to say, by God, I won't let that happen to me again. I'm going to learn everything I can from it.
How had it happened? What had gone wrong? And what lessons were there to learn? Some 6 years earlier, President John F. Kennedy had publicly challenged the Soviet Union to a race to the moon.
Now it is time to take longer strides. Time for a great new American enterprise. Time for this nation to take a clearly leading role in space achievement, which in many ways may hold the key to our future on Earth.
In agreeing to Kennedy's goal, NASA had accepted a terrible engineering burden, a burden paid with three lives. Robert Siemens, former deputy director of NASA.
The reaction throughout NASA was traumatic. Everyone blamed themselves for the accident. On a national basis, it showed how closely the public identified themselves with the astronauts, and it was a kind of thing that was taken quite personally on a national basis. To me, what it proved from the standpoint of management was that we had stupidly forgotten to run one very important test, but we had no idea how bad a fire was going to be until we had one. We had a pure oxygen atmosphere for good reason, but the fire just spread very rapidly. Soon consumed all of the oxygen in the capsule, and there was just no chance of saving the lives of those three astronauts.
Three months after the Apollo fire, cosmonaut Vladimir Komarov becomes Russia's first space fatality. Aboard the new Soyuz spacecraft, the cosmonaut is forced to make an emergency re-entry for still unknown reasons. During re-entry, the parachute lines become entangled. The vehicle slams into the Earth at an estimated 400 miles per hour, killing Komarov instantly. It is almost 2 years, not until 1968, before NASA is again ready to fly into space in a totally redesigned spacecraft. The American lives lost in the Apollo tragedy gain NASA the engineering time it needs. There have been political casualties as well. In Washington, the fire raises doubts about NASA and the moon landing. An internal NASA report surfaces on Capitol Hill. Written before the fire, it charges serious quality control problems with the spacecraft contractor. When first questioned about the report, NASA denies its existence. Congressional support dwindles. NASA's political champion always had been Lyndon Johnson, now United States president following the assassination of John Kennedy. But civil unrest at home and an expensive and unpopular war abroad force other priorities on Johnson. America's space budget suffers the first of many cuts. NASA's chief administrator, James Webb, resigns days before the first Apollo mission. On October 11, 1968, Apollo rises from its ashes to fly again. Mission commander Wally Schirra had attempted to name his spacecraft the Phoenix, but NASA, fearing unpleasant reminders of the Apollo fire, vetoes the idea. On board the flight, rookie astronaut Walt Cunningham.
You're never sure on a first flight of any vehicle that you've closed all the holes that there might be in it. But we knew, as sure as we're sitting here, that when they had that fire, that when it flew again, it would be in one whole lot better shape than it had been originally.
The redesigned Apollo craft proves exceptionally spaceworthy. So confident is NASA that it reveals an extraordinary plan. On only its second flight in space, Apollo will fly 500,000 miles to the moon and back. The United States is also hearing Soviet footsteps. By 1968, Russia has already launched animal payloads to the moon and back. The new Soyuz spacecraft is now operating, and intelligence reports hint of a large Soviet super rocket sitting on the launch pad. At Cape Kennedy, Von Braun's gigantic Saturn V rolls to the launch pad. It is the mechanized triumph of the modern world, our pyramid of the 20th century, the largest and most powerful machine ever built, a rocket which has never before flown a man. Frank Borman.
I think it weighed almost 7 million pounds, 6.8 million pounds. And climbing out on it at that particular December day was a cold day. And it was a sobering experience. It was totally quiet. Every other time we'd been around that vehicle, there'd been hundreds of people, but today it was fully loaded. And I think it had an explosive equivalent about equal to a small atom bomb.
The engines roar like a million claps of thunder, an unearthly sound that is felt more than heard, shooting off a flame more brilliant to the eye than the sun.
Say from then on it was a kind of a detached feeling. The staging, though, from the first to the second stage, as we went from S1C cutoff to S2 ignition, was a violent maneuver. We were thrown against the straps and then smashed back into the seat. And then when we got on the S-4B, it was just a piece of cake. It was the smoothest ride in the world.
Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders are traveling faster than any human ever before. They are the first to slip away from the grasp of Earth. Ahead, a quarter of a million miles of uncertainty.
When we took off, the moon was here, and we aimed over there for where it would be. The moon was just a crescent at that time. We never even saw it. We aimed for a point in space. We hoped that the moon would be 60 miles away from it. And I remember looking down at the exact millisecond we were supposed to be able to see the lunar surface. There it was. There it was. Incredible. We just looked with a sense of awe.
Jim Lovell.
And that's the only color that we could see in the universe. The moon is all gray, all shades of gray. The stars, of course, are the same as we see here on Earth. But the only color was the Earth itself, the blues of the oceans, the pink and the tans and the salmons of the land masses, and of course the white clouds and the polar caps. I often wondered about, you know, a traveler coming home or coming to the Earth for the very first time, what he thought about the body he was about to try to land on. And then it really is sort of like a grand oasis in the vastness of space.
On Earth, the world watches. It is Christmas Eve, 1968, and a new experience for humanity, shared on a global scale.
For all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
As triumphant an event as Apollo 8 had been, NASA leaders could hardly take time to celebrate. Only 12 months remain in which to meet Kennedy's challenge to land a man on the moon before the end of the decade. The next mission, Apollo 9, blazes a new, if not so spectacular, trail. For the first time, the lunar module is tested in space. This flimsy vehicle is the world's first true manned spacecraft. It can travel only in the vacuum of space. 2 months later, Apollo 10 conducts a full dress rehearsal of the moon landing. Astronauts Gene Cernan and Tom Stafford fly the lunar module down near the moon's surface. They miss being the first humans to land on another world by a mere 50,000 feet. That opportunity will go to the crew of Apollo 11. Commander Neil Armstrong is perhaps the best test pilot of all the astronauts. A civilian, he had flown the X-15 rocket in the early 60s. Buzz Aldrin is known as an intense mathematician who excels in rendezvous computations. Mike Collins is the third member. He will stay behind in the command ship while Armstrong and Aldrin fly down to the lunar soil. Like others, even within NASA, Collins has his own personal doubts.
Before the flight, I thought that we might bring the whole thing off exactly as planned, or we might not, and I thought the odds were fairly even. I thought we'd probably get back with our skin, at least I certainly would with mine, because I didn't have the additional problem of having to go down and land on the surface of the moon and then get back up into orbit. But I thought the chances of it coming off 100% successfully were about 50-50. I think in talking to Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin after the flight, they were more optimistic. They thought the odds were considerably better than that, and it's not something that you tend to talk about before a flight. You know, say, hey guys, what do you figure, 50-50? I mean, you keep that to yourself.
July 16, 1969, and the beginning of humankind's most historic voyage. For 4 days, the world waits as the crew travels the quarter of a million miles to lunar orbit.
Apollo 11, this is Houston. I've got the morning news here, if you're interested, over.
Yeah, we sure are. We're ready to copy and comment.
Okay, first off, looks like it's going to be impossible to get away from the fact that you guys are dominating all the news back here in Earth. Even Pravda in Russia is headlining the mission and calls Neil the czar of the ship. I think maybe they got the wrong mission.
Okay, retro, go. Fido, go.
On Sunday, July 20th, the lunar module Eagle separates from the command module Columbia.
Capcom, we're go for undocking.
Roger, Eagle, undock.
Roger, how did you look?
Eagle,
go
ahead and
see. Roger.
You got right down UF1.
If all goes according to plan, Eagle will land in 12 minutes. But should anything go wrong, no one can help.
There are no landing gear on my command module. If they were stuck on the surface of the moon, I could not go down and land and pick them up. Now, if they could limp up into some lopsided orbit, I might or might not be able to go rescue them, just depending on how bad that orbit was.
1201.
Roger, 1201
alarm.
1201
alarm.
Stand by for go flight.
Okay, we're
5 minutes into the flight, the first of several alarms sounds. Eagle's landing computer is overloaded.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
The landing site is now in view, but no one knows that Eagle's computer is filled with incorrect information. Instead of a smooth landing site, Armstrong and Aldrin are headed straight for a field of boulders. They are now less than 2,000 feet and 3 minutes away from landing. The astronauts take over from the computer and become pilots.
4.5 down, 5.5 down. 100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward.
Okay, 75 feet. That's looking good. Down a half. Pitch forward. 60 seconds.
Eagle has only 60 seconds of fuel remaining in its descent engine. The mission is now in danger of being aborted. 100 feet above the surface, lunar dust kicked up by the engines obscures the landing site. As Aldrin calls out the numbers, Armstrong feels his way down, using large boulders in the distance as a reference.
Picking up some dust. Great shadow. Four forward, drifting to the right a little.
30 seconds.
Forward. Contact light. Okay, engine stop.
With less than 30 seconds of fuel, Armstrong and Aldrin touch down on the lunar surface. The nearly 5 billion year old moon has its first visitors.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
CBS television journalist Walter Cronkite.
Everything about it, of course, was just unbelievable. Denied some of us even our facility at speech.
Wally, say something. I'm speechless.
What?
Okay, we're going to be busy for a minute.
I'd been preparing for the moon landing for years, and when it happened, I really found myself almost speechless. Just really couldn't get hold of myself for a moment. Just a sensational moment. Not only that the technical achievement of landing man on the moon, but getting the pictures back and the sound back so that we saw the event take place, I think was just as much a miracle as the space flight.
Yeah, man. It's very fine.
Boy, look at those pictures. Wow.
There's that foot coming down.
There he is. Yeah. There's a foot coming down the steps.
These ghostly images are the record of our first footsteps into the universe around us.
It's a little shadowy, but he said he expected that in the shadow of the lunar module. Armstrong is on the moon, Neil Armstrong, 38-year-old American, standing on the surface of the moon. On this July 20th, 1969.
It's one small step for man. One giant leap for mankind. Dear men from the planet Earth, first set foot upon the moon, July 1969, AD. It came in peace for all mankind.
The triumph of the moon landing is proclaimed in the name of all mankind, but it is the American flag that is raised over the moonscape.
Go ahead, Mr. President. This is Houston out.
Hello, Neil and Buzz. I'm talking to you by telephone from the Oval Room at the White House. And this certainly has to be the most historic telephone call ever made. For one priceless moment in the whole history of man, all the people on this earth are truly one. One in their pride in what you have done. And one in our prayers that you will return safely to Earth.
Tranquility Base, Houston. You're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
Roger.
After spending a sleepless night on the moon, Armstrong and Aldrin safely blast off and reunite with the mothership Columbia to begin the journey back to Earth. The crew of Apollo 11 lands 8 days after leaving Cape Kennedy.
And the flags are waving and the cigars are being lit up.
There are concerns about biological contamination. Looking truly like aliens from another world, the three heroes and their 50 pounds of lunar cargo are placed in quarantine for 21 days. Kennedy's goal has been reached before the end of the decade. The race is over. America is first to the finish line. After the lunar flyaround of Apollo 8, the Soviet Union redirected its flights to near-Earth missions. The much-rumored large Russian rocket would never fly. There are reports of a prototype Soviet superbooster exploding seconds after its liftoff, just some 2 weeks before Armstrong and Aldrin landed on the moon. The rumors have never been confirmed. After the historic landing of Apollo 11, six more missions are planned to the moon. The first is Apollo 12. Mission commander, Pete Conrad.
The weather had gotten quite bad at the Cape, and we had now gotten down to where it was about a 600-foot overcast, and the tops were supposed to be 20,000 feet, and it was raining quite heavily. And at that time, they had to make a decision whether the launch rules as we had them would be violated, and they were concerned with were there any thunderstorms in the area, and we agreed we wanted to launch. If you slipped one of those launches, if you missed the window, you missed for 28 days. I told them the Navy was always glad to do the all-weather testing for them, and didn't take me very long to regret that statement.
36 seconds into the flight, the Apollo spacecraft is twice hit by lightning.
The conditions were such that we generated our lightning, which discharged. That was a rather sizable event. You know, I'm sitting there with the abort handle, and I can abort $365 million worth of going to the moon vehicle, and I really didn't want to do that, but also didn't want to wind up in orbit with a dead spacecraft, or we'd be in deep trouble also.
We've been out of problems here. I don't know what happened. I'm not sure we can get hit by lightning.
We've had a couple of cardiac arrests down here, too, Pete.
There wasn't any time for that up here.
I felt that we'd had such a tremendous glitch that for sure we weren't going to get to go to the moon. We'd probably go around a couple of times and come home and try it again sometime. And the decision was made that we'd keep on going.
Hello, Houston. Yankee Clipper with Intrepid in tow has arrived on time. Just like everybody else that just arrived, we're all three of us are plastered to the windows looking.
Yeah, for the Navy troops, it doesn't look like a very good place to pull liberty, though.
Man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me.
As Pete Conrad walks on the moon, further cuts are being made in NASA's space budget. NASA had lived by the slogan, "A man on the moon by the end of the decade." Now it would suffer the inevitable consequences. The political goals of putting a man on the moon had been met. Now a horrified NASA could only watch as public interest vanishes. Only one other Apollo flight would ignite the imagination of the world, the unlucky voyage of Apollo 13. At 13:13 Houston time, Apollo 13 is launched. On board are Commander Jim Lovell, Lunar Module Pilot Fred Hayes, and Command Module Pilot Jack Swigert. Halfway to the moon on April 13th, the crew finishes a live television broadcast.
This is the crew of Apollo 13, wishing everybody there a nice evening, and we're just about ready to close out our suspension of Aquarius and get back for a pleasant evening at Odyssey. Good night.
Before the crew retires for the evening, Mission Control makes one final request.
13, we've got one more item for you when you get a chance. We'd like it to stir up your cryo tanks.
Stand by.
I was coming down the tunnel carrying the TV camera, and just as I got to the bottom, I heard a sharp bang and the spacecraft rocked back and forth. Then everything was quiet. Fred Hayes normally had thrown a valve, an oxygen valve, that gave sort of a hiss bang, and he enjoyed doing it because Jack Swiker and I were startled every time we heard it, thinking that something hit the spacecraft, and I thought that Fred was doing this test again, and I was going to look up the tunnel to sort of chastise him, saying, "Aren't you overdoing it?" But when I saw Fred's face, I knew that he didn't know what caused the bang. And Jack, of course, over on the left-hand side, his eyes were as wide as saucers.
Hey, Houston, we've had a problem here.
Can I say again, please?
Houston, we've had a problem. Main B bus unavailable.
Roger, main B undervolt. Stand by, 13, we're looking at it.
One of the two oxygen tanks on the service module has exploded. Worse yet, the blast has ruptured the backup.
And then I drifted over to where Jack was sitting in the left-hand side of the spacecraft and looked out past him out the window. And I could see venting at a high rate of speed a gaseous substance. And it didn't take much intelligence on my part to realize that that gas escaping and the needle on my second and last oxygen tank gauge were one of the same. And pretty soon we'd be out completely of oxygen.
Okay, Houston, are you still in 13?
That's affirmative. We're reading you. We're trying to come up with some good ideas here for you.
Okay, now let's everybody keep cool. We got the lens still attached. The lens spacecraft's good, so if we need...
With the command module rapidly losing oxygen, only one option remains.
We figure we've got about 15 minutes worth of power left in the command module, so we want you to start getting over in the limb and getting some power on that.
That sounds like good news.
The crew abandons ship and takes refuge in the lunar module. This lifeboat has its own separate power and oxygen supply. It is designed for a maximum lifetime of 45 hours. The trip back to Earth will take 90. Gene Kranz.
We knew we had a good LEM spacecraft. We had demonstrated it in several previous missions. We also had the lifeboat procedures in hand. We knew we would have to invent many things. But basically, we had a very well-trained flight control team. We had a very well-trained crew, and basically the issue was to take those bits and pieces that we already had, figure out what new things we had to invent, set up the procedures to manage the power, which is our critical consumable, and then the water and several of the other consumables downstream, and just make sure that we didn't do anything that closed out our options.
Jim Lovell.
Well, that question is often asked. Did you panic when you found out that you were in a very catastrophic situation? And the answer really is no, because even if we did panic for 10 minutes and bounce off the walls, we would be right back where we started from when we finished. So it was amazing that all three of us went right to work to try to see how we could get home. But our closest point of approach to the Earth would be about 2,500 nautical miles. Consequently, we would essentially be in a long elliptical orbit, you know, for almost forever if we had done nothing. And our first concern was, let's try to do something to get us back to the Earth, to land on the Earth somehow, even though it might not be successful, rather than to be a permanent monument to the space program.
Mission Control calculates that if the Apollo crew conserves all consumables, they can last the 90 hours it will take to return to Earth. But in order to get back, they must first swing around the moon and make a critical engine burn with the only rocket remaining. The machine designed to land them on the moon now must put them on course for Earth.
Right after our second burn to get us home quicker, we turned off everything except the radio to talk to the Earth and a fan that would circulate the atmosphere within the spacecraft. And when that happened, of course, we started losing our heat.
Jim Houston, have you guys put on any extra clothes to try and ward off the nip of Jack Frost? Over.
Well, we're going to lose two pair of underwear.
Oh, okay. Incidentally, you're less than 24 hours to go.
Also, because it got cold, the humidity in the spacecraft started to condense out the moisture, and we started getting moisture all over the inside of the spacecraft, especially the command module. And of course, we had to use the command module to get back through the atmosphere, so we were quite worried that this moisture would get behind the electrical equipment, the switches, and start shorting out the items that we needed for the reentry.
Yeah, it's kind of a cold winter day up there, isn't it? Is it snowing in the command module yet?
No, not quite. The windows are in pretty bad shape. Every window in the command module is covered with water droplets. Take water droplets and get those cleared off. We never discussed situations like this. What do you do if you're stranded? I guess it was always in the back of everybody's mind. If you wanted to kill yourself in a spacecraft instead of taking a suicide pill, all you had to do was reach down and unlock or just open up the vent valve, and shortly all the oxygen would have been out of the spacecraft. But my plan was that we would last as long as we possibly could, even though we had whistled by the Earth site, and keep putting
back as much data as possible until we ran out of just about everything. And then that would be the end of it.
As they near the Earth, the Apollo 13 crew separates from the service module and for the first time sees the full damage from the oxygen tank blast.
We copied that report from Jim Lovell of service module separation at 138 hours, 2 minutes, 8 seconds.
And there's one whole side of that street missing.
Is that right?
The cause of the accident occurred 5 years before we took off. At that time, NASA asked all the contractors to make their electrical systems compatible with the high voltage at Cape Kennedy, about 65 volt DC power. Everybody did except the fellow who built the heater system in the oxygen tank. That heater system had a little thermostat that was only compatible with 28 volt power. Our tank was dropped to the factory, we found out later in the investigation. And to get rid of the oxygen during one of the tests, instead of the normal detanking procedure, they turned on the heater system using the high voltage. Well, the little thermostat wasn't capable of protecting the wiring, and it was welded shut due to the high voltage. And the high voltage then kept the temperature rising, and it damaged all of the heater wiring, but no one ever caught it on the launch pad. Consequently, when we refilled it up just before takeoff with oxygen, it was a bomb waiting to go off.
Following the recovery of the Apollo 13 crew, 4 more missions fly and land successfully on the moon. Each mission is more ambitious than the last, despite a few diversions.
Houston, while you're looking at it, you might recognize what I have in my hand is the handle for the contingency sample return. It just so happens to have a genuine six iron on the bottom of it. In my left hand, I have a little white pellet that's familiar to millions of Americans. Unfortunately, the suit is so stiff, I can't do this with 2 hands, but I'm going to try a little sand trap shot here.
That looked like a slice to me, Al.
Oh, you missed the other side.
What? No, you missed, Frank. Good Lord, look at that hole we almost landed in.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
Now, May.
May.
May to
May, that's right.
Come on out here and give me a salute. Big Davey salute. Okay, here we go, a big one.
In these last missions of Apollo, adventure gives way to science as the astronaut turns full-time prospector. Scientists had hoped that the lunar samples might answer some of the mysteries about the origins of the moon, the birth of our solar system, and the universe. They have not. Yet the information locked inside the moon rocks may be the key to spaceflight in the 21st century. Physicist Jerry O'Neill.
From our present viewpoint, Apollo was a huge success, and it was a success as a prospecting operation. What we brought back from it was information about what the moon is made of. The lunar soils are made of metals and silicon, oxygen, all elements that we can use for large-scale construction in space. It's very much the same as prospecting for a new oil field. That's what we got from Apollo. Unfortunately, we didn't know at the time that that was going to be the most valuable result.
This is Gene, and I'm on the surface. And as I take man's last step from the surface, back home for some time to come, but we believe not too long into the future, I'd like to just let what I believe history will record, that America's challenge of today has forged man's destiny of tomorrow. And as we leave the moon and Taurus Littoral, we leave as we came, and God willing, as we shall return with peace and hope for all mankind. Godspeed, the crew of Apollo 17.
Meanwhile, the Soviet Union continues placing its attention on near-Earth missions. In 1971, the world's first space station, Salyut, is launched and reaches orbit. The first crew to successfully dock and board the station sets a new duration record of 22 days in space. But on their return home, all three men are killed. Soviet space observer Jim Oberg.
Evidently, when they separated one section of the spacecraft, it jarred open a pressure valve, in the hull of the ship that was designed to equalize air pressure once they were down on the ground. But as it was, they were still in space, and the valve let the air out of their capsule in about 30 seconds. The ship had an autopilot. In fact, it landed quite normally. As far as the whole country was concerned, this was probably one of the most traumatic psychological events of the generation. And the reason for this is that it came only 2 years after the Apollo 11 moon landing. The Salyut 1 space station was seen as being the Russian answer to the moon flights, being not a wild goose chase off into deep space, but a more practical setting up of a space station in Earth orbit. But the deaths of these men, after 3 weeks of national TV shows and everyone's getting ready to celebrate, they had triumphal parades, had in fact already been planned, and the material had been prepared for the parades. And instead, they had funerals.
America launches its first space station in 1973. But within 1 minute of clearing the tower, telemetry signals show that something has gone wrong. In orbit, but underpowered and overheating, Skylab is in serious trouble. 11 days later, Pete Conrad, Joseph Kerwin, and Paul Weitz rendezvous with the space station. A fly-around inspection confirms the damage. The lab's protective shield is gone. One solar panel is partially deployed, the other is missing. Mission commander Pete Conrad.
So we get up there and ascertained what the problem was and got all depressurized and got Paul hanging out the hatch with Joe hanging on his legs and drove up to it, and he hooked on, and he'd start to pull, and all he was doing was pulling 35 or 45,000 pounds worth of command module right smack into the lab, and I'd back off, and then Joe would be hollering because he was having a hard time hanging on to him as I was about to pull him out of the hatch. It just didn't work. So we gave that up.
The crew docks and enters the damaged Skylab. After deploying a temporary heat shield, temperatures begin to drop.
While they were developing these procedures on the ground, we were really kind of in a power down mode. We didn't have all the juice we needed. And it was beginning to put a reasonably severe strain on the ATM solar panels, and it was very vital. Skylab really wouldn't have made it if we didn't get that solar panel out.
To free the solar panel, Conrad and Kerwin make an emergency spacewalk repair.
And I told Joe to pull as hard as he could, and I went out and got in the middle of the solar panel and got the rope over my head and played like I was a bow and arrow and started pushing up on it. And I was pushing for all I was worth, and Joe was pulling for all he was worth, and the snubber broke, and it launched me just like a bow and arrow. I mean, I just took off right out the boonies. But obviously, I had an umbilical, so I, you know, wasn't lost in space, but I I did get shot out of there quite good, and so I didn't have the pleasure of seeing the panel deploy. I was going ass over tea kettles out there about 20 feet from it when it came flying up and locked, and so we got the panel out. And make long story short, that really was the thing that kept Skylab up there, was to get that panel out.
Conrad's crew had saved Skylab. They would stay in space for 28 days, the first of three crews to study the Earth and solar system from this science laboratory in space. From these NASA films, life aboard Skylab seems a wonderland of play. But the third crew would find itself battling with mission planners over a question as old as America's manned space program. Who was in control? The commander of the third Skylab mission, Jerry Carr.
The mission was planned. Almost every minute of the mission was planned from the minute we got up until the minute we went to bed. We ran on a very, very tight schedule. And after about 20 or so days of that, you began to feel like a little white rat running through the maze, or the donkey following the carrot, because there was no latitude, not very much latitude, for any kind of personal activity, nor was there any latitude to exercise your own judgment, swap jobs around, or do something in a different order. And that caused a great deal of discomfort for us, because as human beings, I think intelligent people will only follow the carrot for so long, and then they begin to get bored, and their productivity goes down. And we were certainly manifesting all of those characteristics at that time. And we became more and more concerned about the fact that we were getting less and less productive. You don't get up at 6 o'clock in the morning and immediately start to work and squeeze in breakfast wherever you can, and take a half hour off for lunch, and then work all afternoon and squeeze in three quarters of an hour for dinner, and then work till bedtime, and then get in the sack and expect to conk right out and go to sleep and wake up again at six and do the same thing all over again. And we began to realize that any little minutes we had where we could look out the window and see the view, or fool around with a ball of water to see what it did in a weightless environment, those little minutes of private time became very precious to us. And we began to realize that, gee, you have that kind of time down here on the ground when you have a job. You don't work those kinds of hours or under that kind of a regimen. So we really should be trying to do that up here, because it's important over very long-term missions that we be assured of the fact that man can find a comfortable lifestyle in a weightless environment. We finally got to a point on this one Sunday, on this day off, we decided, look, we've been following the carrot for so long that we really need the freedom to do what we want to do today, and so we're not going to accept any extra work today, thank you. We're just going to do what we want to do. So I guess you would you'd say that that was probably what they've called the first mutiny in space. But we gathered enough information about the sun taken from outside the Earth's atmosphere to keep the solar physics community busy for about 10 or 15 years. We made some really excellent observations that have been of great value to geologists and volcanologists and land use experts here on the ground, and oceanographers as well. And in the area of medical science, I think we essentially proved that as long as man exercises and takes care of his body, that he can stay in a weightless environment for very, very long periods of time.
The final Apollo mission is launched in July of 1975. It is not a mission to the moon or to a space station, but an historic rendezvous in space with the Soviet Union. On board the Apollo spacecraft are Tom Stafford, Vance Brand, and Deke Slayton, one of the original Mercury astronauts. Slayton, grounded by a minor heart condition in 1962, has waited 15 years for this one flight into space.
The majority of the challenge was related to dealing with people that had been antagonists for a whole lot of years and learning to work with them. And when you're in space, you're going over the whole darn world of pieces of it every 90 minutes, you know, and when we get to the point where people are doing that regularly, it's hard to envision how you can keep fighting over little borders drawn on a piece of paper down here on the surface of the Earth.
The Apollo program had cost the American taxpayer some $24 billion. Its original purpose had been to defeat the Soviet Union in a test of political and industrial strength. Now, in the era of detente, Apollo would close with a handshake in space.
Glad to see you.
Apollo remains a demonstration of the genius of humankind, a quest born not of instincts for science or adventure, but of unabashed competition. That was its genesis, but what of its meaning for now and tomorrow?
I look upon going to the moon in the context of planetary exploration, or maybe even more basic than that, of leaving the surface of the planet. To leave or to stay, to have that option, that's something in the history of mankind we've never had before. Just the going to the moon is just the first faltering step toward going to Mars, leaving our solar system, of going off to the far reaches of the universe, to leaving. What was going to the moon all about? It was about leaving.